Well, hidey ho, good neighbors.
Howdy.
What's up, Beezy?
How you doing, Pinewood?
How are you doing?
I'm just peachy, baby.
Well, you look great.
I'm plumptable.
Plumptable?
Plumptable.
And shirtless.
Yeah, of course.
Pretty much standard.
That's the only way to do it, man.
Well, we're coming at you. I was going to say we're coming at you hot and live. That sounds weird.
Yeah, especially when I'm half articled.
That's true.
That's true.
I tell you what, welcome all of you out there, all of you, even the Todd Toms, welcome. We're glad that you're here. Even
occasionally.
We'll delete you, but we're glad that you're here. We want to start with saying thank you so much for making our bonus episode a roaring success.
Roaring.
Right out of the gate.
Yes.
Trying the dirty domestics.
That was the second episode of podcasts that we've had that topped the charts on iTunes again before it even released.
I believe we went number one.
Number one. Yep. It actually went 0.5.
Really?
It beat the number one slot.
Better than number one.
I'm telling you. I don't know how we did it.
I believe, if I'm not mistaken, we got an email from Joe Rogan asking if we could give him some pointers.
Yeah, I think that's... I didn't see that one. I deleted it because, you know, I mean...
We don't have chump time. Change. We don't have time for that. You know, he did move to Texas. I mean, we might be able to go down there.
He did just get his podcast purchased by Spotify, so...
It was for chump change, though, like $100 million or something like that.
Something like that. Yeah,
but I'm more happy and excited that he moved to Texas.
Yeah, even better.
Even better.
We should put him on our team.
I would much rather have young Jamie on our team than, than Rogan.
That's true.
That is true. I don't know. We'll see. I'll send him an email, see if he'd be willing to give up some of that Spotify change.
Yeah.
And, come help us.
I mean, what would be the reasoning to turn that down? I mean, here we are sitting in the doghouse.
We are in the doghouse today, and I got something specially for you. I found something specially for you. You ready?
Beautiful. I love it already. Oh. I'm in the doghouse now. Oh, yeah.
What do you think about that?
In the doghouse now.
Okay.
Oh yeah,
I think that's all we can play legally.
Yeah, I think so too.
So I have a challenge for all of our listeners.
Oh yeah,
all four of them. So what I'd like for you to do is to go find this gentleman on YouTube. His name is Rocky Jackson, which is a fantastic name, and he is a jazz guitar player and a blues artist, and his YouTube page has
four whole subscribers.
Yes. Now that glorious music you just heard only warrants four subscribers.
Dang.
So
well, we need to get all 10 of our subscribers on YouTube to hop over to his channel, and just then he could have more than us.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask each and every one of you to get on YouTube and go find Rocky Jackson in the doghouse now, and say in the comments, because as you can imagine, there's no comments. Say in the comments that Fraternize with These Guys sent you to find him.
That's beautiful.
And hopefully we'll get our first copyright strike.
Woo!
I figured once we get one copyright strike down,
we're in the doghouse again.
We're well on our way to becoming big time.
Yeah.
So speaking of the bonus episode,
yep.
I was very surprised.
Me too, man.
Two beers.
Dub beers?
No, just two of Dub beers, not all of them. So we had Miller High Life, the Banquet Beer Coors, Red Can Budweiser.
Yeah.
We had, let's see, what was the light? We had a Bush beer.
And then we had Natty Light.
Natty Light. Now, if I'm not mistaken, according to our Facebook page, you finished
Natty Light. I did. Yeah. After we finished recording that episode, I polished that puppy off because it was pretty decent. I was not upset with it. So I just gave her the old heave-ho and chug-a-lugged it.
So decent. You're going to stick with decent.
Pretty decent, man. It definitely came out way on top out of the five.
Well, if I remember right, the Red Can came out on top.
Well, yeah, but that was just for shenanigans, semantics, just because Natty Light was a light and we were trying to do full bodies.
That's a fair point. So Natty Light kind of slid in there as a, what should we call it, with an asterisk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like a Barry Bonds.
And the,
it's the Barry Bonds of the
Mark McGuire. And the reason was, quite honestly, we couldn't find another full-bodied beer.
No.
We tried to find PBRs.
Yeah. That
and
was
we couldn't.
Just non-existent.
I'm very disappointed that in Texas, we could not find a PBR.
Yeah.
Or a Lone Star.
Yeah, that was the biggest change. I'm surprised we couldn't find Lone Star.
Now, to be fair, we could find all of those beers in 30 packs.
Yeah, but no.
We're not going to buy a 30 pack.
I'm not going to waste that money.
Yeah, and if we did buy a 30 pack, it would probably sit in this doghouse for a long time. A long time.
I mean, we could figure out a way to grow a beer tree because they'd be sitting there that long.
We could plant them in the backyard.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I will say, you know, a lot of people say you save that kind of beer and you give it to your friends that come over.
Yeah.
But I would not dare serve that. I do too. I wouldn't serve that in my house.
Yeah.
Maybe even if I didn't like them.
I mean, it depends on who it was.
Yeah.
But I will say, along the lines, we threw out a little turning the bonus episode into a drinking game. And I got to say, my brother Matt is a champion because he actually, I believe at some point we had said, somebody should count how many times we said W-ears, and
that's true. Because that was the rules of the game.
Yeah, anytime we said one of those, you had to take a drink.
Okay, and not us, by the way.
Yeah, we didn't have to take the drink.
Y'all had to take the drink.
But the listeners, all two of you.
And how many, can you remember how many there was?
Yeah, he said we said W-ears 17 times.
Wow.
And then we said, that's true, 18.
Okay.
I really felt like we said it more than that, but...
Okay, so just shy of 40, so yeah. in that high 30s mark, high 30s drink, and if I remember right, the power hour is 60 shots.
It's a shot of beer a minute.
Every minute for an hour.
Yeah.
So if you're playing this game, it wouldn't mess you up just quite as much as the drinking, as a power hour.
Terribly bad.
And if you've never played the power hour, please don't.
Yeah, it's brutal.
Yeah. My pastoral recommendation is not to do the power hour ever.
I think our legal team advised us to not suggest doing that one.
Okay. All right. And we're going to hear from some of our legal team a little bit later, which is, that's exciting stuff.
That's our first advertisement.
It is our first sponsor.
I know.
Legit awesome. Sponsor.
I know. It's
going to be beauty. Excited about that. It's really bad for that sponsor that we've included them on the power hour idea, but we're excited about
Could
that.
Could be fun.
Could be fun. Hey, I tell you what, let's go right into our libations.
Libations! God, I love that.
It's good stuff, man.
Just feels good in my loins.
You really knocked it out of the park with that.
That was a one-taker, too.
It was. That's right. So, Ray Charles in it over here.
I'm telling you.
That's why we pay you the big bucks.
That's why I said back in the bonus episode, I'm a champion. Champion at everything I do, even recording.
Mainly because we just tell you that.
That's fair.
Yeah, that is fair. I tell you what, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay.
How about you introduce what we're drinking today?
All right. Well, this is a first for the both of us.
It is.
And a first for the podcast as well. We're actually going to be drinking a mead, a honey mead.
I feel like a Viking.
I know. Dude, and I'll be honest with you, with the bottle that this thing came in.
The bottle looks legit.
If this thing tastes like hot garbage, this is still going to probably be the sexiest bottle we have ever had in the studios.
So maybe we should have a second ranking for the bottle.
Just the coolness factor of the bottles.
Yeah. Wouldn't change a thing. Three out of five stars. Yeah, the bottle's pretty legit. It kind of reminds me of a Grolsch or a Gulsch?
Yeah, I got nothing on that one.
So there's a beer out there. I think it's Gulsch. or Grolsch, I can't remember. It's a domestic beer from another country, so I guess not domestic. I don't know why I said that.
So not domestic.
Not domestic. It is domestic somewhere.
Somewhere.
You can buy these, and they come in these really fancy-looking bottles, and not a great beer.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about now.
Yeah.
It's G with the O with the two dots above it.
Something like that.
L-C-H.
I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, like, yeah, like a Kolsch, you. But Grolsch.
But a Grolsch.
Yeah. So,
Ghoulsh.
Anyway, if you want an idea of what the bottle looks like, you can check out that, or you can check us out on Facebook because we're going to put a picture of this bottle up.
Yes,
because it's pretty fancy.
It is. Well, back to what we're drinking,
please.
This is, like I said, a honey mead, and it comes from the Honey Buzz Winery. Up in Canyon, Texas.
A beer from a winery?
A beer? Well, I guess it's a mead.
Okay, a mead.
A mead from a winery.
I'm suspect already.
Well, I don't know, man. This place was actually, my stepmom has a indoor-outdoor market, and I guess this is one of the vendors, and she was telling me about it because they also import some meads that are just ridiculously high-powered.
Yes, so the meads, if I'm not mistaken, they whenever they brew them, they brew at a much higher ABV than normal beer. Is that correct? Yes, for the most part?
From what I recall.
Okay.
Reading.
Reading?
Yeah. And you can't hold me to that because I was reading it.
Well, that's fair. But I believe the one that we got from them that is actually bottled from somebody else, like quote-unquote a professional mead, is like 19%.
Yes. Yeah, so that other one that we got.
Super hefty.
It's called, and we haven't tasted it yet, so and we're not going to talk about it just okay. yet. But the one that we're doing tonight is called, it's just a cranberry orange.
Okay.
And they say it is a spiced, sparkling holiday mead with a kick.
Okay.
And this is, like you said, 12.5% ABV. And
wow.
You're the one that actually went and picked this up on the way to the doghouse this afternoon. That's right.
So traveling to the doghouse, made a pit stop. And I will say, if you're in the area, and I know not everybody's in Texas, but if you're in especially the northern part of Texas, there's a little town called Canyon. Both of us went to school there. It's a great little community. And this is where it's located. And they have beehives there. And so they raise their own bees and make their own honey. And they brew this mead there on site. And it's a great place because you can go there with your wife and you can tell her, we're going to a special place just for you. And you can let her peruse in the gift area. And there's so many wonderful things for women there, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But it's also a place that we would hate.
Normally.
However, there is a side bar that serves...
Sold.
Whole locally made mead. And there's like 17 options.
That's beautiful.
So you can let your wife spend your money in the gift shop, and you can go and just drink your sorrows away.
Drink sorrows away.
in the mead bar.
I love it.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? We may just have to make a pit stop, see if they'll let us record an episode there.
Yeah, I might have to do it.
And then drink maybe one of these because these are
pretty hefty.
Beefy.
Yes.
I like it because of the 12.5.
Yeah.
I don't think we've had anything that strong yet.
Not yet. And the ambiance of the place is really good. I would definitely go back. And that's kind of embarrassing because it's a little bit girly and, you know.
Whatever. I won't judge you. I'll allow it.
Well, and as the temperature warms up just a bit, they're redoing the outside. So they have some really nice sitting areas. And it would be a really cool destination if you're in the area. So that's Canyon, Texas. And what's it called again?
It's called the Creek House Honey Farm. And then they have the Honey Buzz Winery, I guess, is attached to them. But they're located at 5005 4th Avenue in Canyon, Texas, and they are not sponsors. We're just plugging them because I love my stepmom.
Yep.
So
and by the way, your stepmom shop is
the Prairie Blossom in Wolfrith, Texas,
just right outside of Lubbock.
Yep.
Okay. All right. So two wonderful plugs there. Check those people out. We'll also plug them on our Facebook page.
Yep.
And you can get all that information. Let's go ahead and dive into this. Is it cranberry orange?
Cranberry orange mead.
Okay, here we go.
Holy cannolis, that's good. I was not expecting that, bro.
Well, I'll admit I was expecting I was expecting a par experience.
Huh.
Just average, across the board, something I'd never tried before. And honestly, I was expecting something too sweet.
Yeah. That is... I'm at a loss for words.
Well, when I was in college and in my heavy drinking days, mm-hmm. if you will, we used to take Mike's hard cranberry and mix it with Goldschlager.
Yep.
And it was Christmassy horribleness.
Yep.
Not great. This is like the wonderful advanced version of that.
The sophisticated palate.
I definitely get the cranberry.
Yeah, and then cinnamon. I get cinnamon. I don't know about you.
For sure cinnamon. And it comes out super strong and not overpowering. So I get the cranberry. I don't get the orange so much. But maybe
kind of on the back end.
Maybe so.
Just a little on the back end.
But the citrus and cinnamon mix is a great combination. So whatever they have done there with this beer,
They're crushing it.
It's that very, very good.
Quite tasty.
So I'm impressed.
Now, we'll need to find out if they could ship. Because if they can, then I will post that on the website on Facebook. By the way, check us out on Facebook.
Please.
You can do at FWTG Podcast.
Yes.
Facebook, Instagram. You can search for Fraternize with These Guys.
Even on YouTube.
And the TubeYubes.
Yeah. We have more subscribers than Rocky Johnson.
That's true.
Or whatever his name is. Rocky Jackson.
Rocky Jackson.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. if you guys have questions, even about this tasty, tasty mead, shoot us an email.
Yep.
We'll get in touch with the higher powers and see what we can do about that. But the email is theseguysquestions@gmail.com.
Now, I do know when I went there today, they had 4 packs available of all of their beer and wine. And you can, as far as I know, you can order that. I don't know what the shipping is as far as legality goes.
Sure.
Maybe we can ask our legal experts.
Legal team?
Yeah, maybe we can talk to them a little bit later.
Oh, yeah.
But that'd if you're so inclined, you should check them out and see if they can help you out. Great, great mead.
Yes.
Okay, so if we were to put it on the Libations Library,
uh-huh.
not if, we are.
We are.
Is this a separate category?
I don't know.
I don't consider it a beer.
I still consider it a Libations.
It's definitely a libation.
And in the grand scheme of things, what we're going to plan on doing eventually is we'll have our, I guess now it's going to be beer/mead category.
Yeah.
Then we'll have a spirits category. And then we'll have a wine category. But I feel like this belongs more into the beer than the wine.
I would definitely agree with that. I don't know if I would place it with all the beers.
We can do beer/mead.
Okay. All right. I'm with that. Just with make sure we notate this as a not necessarily a beer, but a...
Is it going to have an asterisk next to it?
Yeah.
Like Martin McGuire?
Yep. Just like Martin McGuire and Barry Rocky Bones. Jackson.
And Rocky Jackson. So what are you feeling like on the old Nuggy scale?
Okay. So here's always is my disclaimer. I'm not a fan of sweet libations.
Mm-hmm.
I like dry, bitter, not so much on the sweet side. So it's a little bit sweet for me, but not overpowering sweet. I'm going to give it a solid 89.
Ooh, that is valid. That is valid, sir.
And one of the reasons I've given it maybe more than I normally would is because we're just coming out of the holidays, and this would make an amazing holiday beverage.
Hot toddy.
If you could serve this in your holiday functions,
yeah,
people would be a fan.
Definitely a Thanksgiving, Christmas, yeah. New Year's
beverage. Even New Year's for sure.
Show.
Yep. It's very, very good. I do like it.
Yeah. I think I'm going to go with just a nice round 90.
So 99 out of 10.
Yeah. It's a solid one, man. I could drink a whole bottle of that and probably be done for the evening.
Yeah, for sure be done for the
evening. But yeah, it's that tasty. It's not too sweet for me.
Okay.
And I really love cinnamon.
There you go.
So this is hitting me in the feels.
And the bottle it comes in is probably,
awesome.
I don't know, probably what, 24 ounces?
Yeah, 16
to 24, somewhere in there. And so
16
ounces. 16
fluid ounces.
So, you know, if if you were by yourself and you had one, you'd probably be all right still.
Oh, yeah.
It'd be the equivalent of what, 3 or 4 beers?
Well, unless we were drinking one of the Doms. It'd be like 18.
Yeah, that's true. Well, great beer, great company. Check those guys out and check out our Facebook if you missed any of that. And we'll have all of that information posted in the next couple of days.
Yep, yep.
For now, how about what we all come here to do? Let's go right into 4 questions. 4 questions. So 4 questions today. We're going to do a little bit different than normal. Normally, we just trade back and forth. I'm going to do 2 questions out of the gate, and then old BC will do 2 questions, and we'll go from there.
Yeah, both of my questions are involving puppies.
Oh, nice. Nice. Yeah. The canines.
The old canines.
Which is fitting in the doghouse.
Yep. I figured, when in Rome.
When in Rome. Okay, so first question. This comes from Rick.
Rick.
Keep that in mind.
Okay.
All right. The question is, should I destroy my boyfriend's AR-15 since he refuses to get rid of it and I'm scared of having a weapon like that in our house? Okay. Now, he clarifies.
Oh, okay. As long as there's some clarification coming up here.
There is. I'm not sure it's going to get any better than that, but there's definitely some clarification. Now, right out of the gate, I'm not super happy with the question. You?
I mean, no, not. I have an AR.
Do you?
I do.
Oh, so you're one of those gun-toting...
gun-toting hillbillies.
Now, how many people have you shot with your AR?
Oh, I mean, I've been shooting people for like 0.00 years.
Good save.
I know.
Good save.
How'd you like that one?
Now, you've shot 0 people. How many people has your AR shot on its own?
Oh, yeah, when it just goes crazy?
Yeah, because, you know, they're prone to do that.
Oh, man, you just, I try to keep a tight leash on it. I try to keep a tight leash.
All you can do is all you can do.
I mean, you know, that's what I'm saying here.
Okay, Rick goes on to explain. I'm just going to read it the way it's written.
Okay.
There is no reasons any civilian needs a gun like that. It's meant for killing. I love my boyfriend, but I'm not going to allow a machine gun in my house. He has handguns. He doesn't need a machine gun. If he refuses to sell it, should I take a sledgehammer and smash it?
Well, here's a common misconception about the R's, and I call them R's because I've been handling them for long enough. It's AR right. for the layman's. But the AR is not a machine gun, first and foremost.
Or is every gun technically a machine gun?
I mean, no.
They're machines.
Whoa, touche, sir, touche.
Right, right. There's mechanical operation that happens regardless of style of said machine. So
okay, fair enough.
And I keep wanting to say she, but obviously
it's a he.
This is a he. So Rick obviously thinks it's acceptable to have a handgun.
Maybe Rick is short for Rickany.
Okay, I'm going to go with no on that.
Yeah,
I'm gonna
fair.
Just Rick.
It's probably Rick.
So, obviously, acceptable to have a handgun machine.
A machine handgun.
A machine handgun. I think what he's trying to say is a fully automatic weapon.
Which is illegal.
Which is illegal for most civilians.
And you have to have proper licensing to even get that.
That's true. And that
is wicked expensive.
Yes, it is.
Looked into it.
And we won't get into all the ifs, ands, and buts about that, but not fully automatic. So I think that's probably the first misconception to talk about.
Yep.
AR-15 is not a fully automatic weapon.
Semi-automatic.
Semi-automatic, yep. Which...
Same thing as a pistol.
Same thing as a pistol, well as quite a few rifles.
Oh, yeah.
So the biggest issue with the AR-15 is it looks scary.
Looks like a murder machine.
It does look like a murder machine. Oh, there's a machine again.
Machine.
So solid black tactical style rifle that if you look into the older wars, because they don't use them anymore, even the platforms, they don't use them anymore.
Sure.
So the older style, you might see them in like Vietnam or Korea or
Korea.
Maybe Ah, oh, we're getting sued for sure.
Yep.
What's your immediate response? What should this gentleman do?
Well, first and foremost, besides the points that we've already discussed,
which is ample.
I mean, you're okay with pistols in the house, but you don't want a murder machine. So, well, I think you just need to find somebody else.
Maybe.
Because you allow pistols, which is a semi-automatic handgun.
Correct.
And you also allow semi-automatic rifles.
Or don't
you
allow.
You don't allow the semi-automatic.
So apparently just the act of placing it upon your shoulder instead of in your hands only, that's where he draws the line.
Well, I mean, you got kits that you can make a pistol.
Yeah, you can make an AR pistol.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't even have to put it on your shoulder.
Exactly.
So literally, it could also be a pistol.
Yup.
With very slight modification.
Yeah.
So
true. So I'm going to say, if he has such an aversion to the assault rifle, and this person is not getting rid of it, just hands down.
Yep.
Not getting rid of it, because that's how I would be.
Sure.
You're like, there's the door, don't let it hit you where the good Lord split you.
And hopefully there would be some education going on.
Also. I would hope so.
I would hope there would be a conversation to be had.
Like all the points that we already pointed out.
Yes. And hopefully Rick will take this issue to the gentleman involved with him and not just blast his grievances online. Because I think that would be more annoying to me than...
Find out that he's blowing guff saying all this nonsense online?
Yes. Yes. If there's a legitimate issue, let's just deal with it.
Yeah. Agreed.
I'm probably not going to give up my AR.
Certainly not.
But we could at least talk through the issue.
I've put a decent amount of money into that one.
They do tend to be a little bit of a money hole.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, even a cheap one.
Yeah.
Ironically,
they're erector sets, bro.
They really are. And ironically, the cheap one, you have to put more money into it to make it shootable.
To make it a good one.
And also, I'll quibble just a bit with his rationalization of their killing machines. Okay. Fair point, kind of. They are killing machines. A gun is designed to do one thing, to kill something or someone.
Sure.
Now, that doesn't mean that it's a good or a bad action. They're just designed to do that.
Right.
So the fact that something's designed for that purpose doesn't necessarily mean that it's good or evil. The handgun that you're okay with is also designed
to kill.
To kill something or someone.
That is actually more of a... I mean, if that's, most people would have it as a home defense.
That's a bonus, right? We're not protecting our houses with slingshots.
Exactly.
I mean, you could. David and Goliath if you want
to. Sure.
And you have every right to protect your home with a slingshot. I'm going to err on the side of a little bit more in my favor.
I like something that moves a little bit quicker.
Me too.
FPS.
Like around 2,500 foot per second.
Yeah. It usually does the trick.
Usually does. And, you know, when it comes to home defense, I'm going to err on the side of a shotgun over an AR.
It's got a spread. Got a spread.
In the click, you know, the shotgun click is just, that's a way to dissuade anyone from going further.
Unless they're wearing their brown pants.
That's true. And even, I will tell you, if somebody's in your house at night and you make that shotgun sound, and they keep coming, you better put them down.
Yep.
Because there's some issues going on.
You better hope that you actually have that shotgun and it's not just an app on your phone.
That's right. I will also say that handguns, rifles, shotguns, for self-defense reasons, save hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people every year by CDC standards.
Sure.
And so, not CDC, whatever the FBI crime statistics algorithm?
I just agreed with you because I haven't been in that field for too terribly long.
It sounded good.
And it really rolled off of the tongue.
Yeah.
CDC is the criminal database.
It is not. That is the disease control.
Oh, that's Center for Disease Control.
Yes, yes. They're more involved with COVID than AR defenses.
That will happen.
But the crime statistic something or another. We're getting way off into the weeds here.
Yep. Yes, and we are.
I'm pretty sure that one of our seven listeners is pissed right now that we don't know this.
Yep.
Correct us.
It's probably Dave.
It probably is Dave. Dave, send us a comment. Let us know what the heck we're talking about.
Yeah, we're idiots.
But of all the people who are quote-unquote killed in like a reckless manner that you would point to say, well, we should take guns off the street, there are multiple thousands of instances that err on the other side, which is people protecting other people or themselves or their homes. And there's not an argument there when you really get into the minutia of the numbers.
Yeah.
Now, I do like one answer. It's actually the first answer. And he says, so just offhand, let me get this straight. You want to piss off the guy who owns handguns. Is that correct?
Touche, Sam. Touche.
So imagine what his reaction will be when he finds out that you have demolished his AR-15.
Yeah, I wouldn't be a happy camper. I'd use the pistol.
I might use the backup pistol. And by the way, if you have an AR-15, you probably have a backup pistol.
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest.
And probably a backup to the backup.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest. good question.
Really good question. I really like that. Well, let's go on to question number two.
All right.
Now, before we go into question number two, I will say on the Mead, which is growing on me, by the way.
As it should.
There are several beers that we've had already that don't grow on you. They kind of do the opposite. As they warm.
Yeah.
This one, as it has warmed up, I'm actually getting more notes of especially the honey.
Yeah.
Because all mead's brewed with a honey base. With honey,
yep.
And so I'm definitely picking up on that as it warms up a little bit.
And, you know, I did pick up a little bit of that about 5 minutes ago-ish.
Okay.
But I drank the rest of it, and it's gone.
So, Beezy is not what we call a sipper.
I'm a champion drinker.
Some of us with more refined palates, we prefer to experience and swish around and really let the experience, you know, take a hold of us.
We address this episode uno.
You can go back to episode one and hear what Mr. Beezy thinks about my refined palate.
Yeah, because it's all trufus. Well, hit me up with number two. Question two, Ski.
How did people who were alive in the 80s work without internet?
That kind of ties into a question we had a couple weeks back.
Maybe? I think so.
Maybe. I think it was apps.
Oh, yeah, it was apps.
Apps on the phone.
Because I succinctly said it wasn't but like 8 years ago.
We didn't have
any apps. So he goes on. This is anonymous.
Of course.
So how do you people who were alive in the 80s work with that internet? We were both alive briefly in the 80s.
Ish.
He says, you need internet and computers for almost every job these days. How did you people...
What do you mean, you people?
How did you people back then work without it? Should be interesting to hear. Oh, I would be interesting to hear if there are any of you still alive.
Wow.
When does this person think the 80s were?
He's got some of that. He been doing some of that new math that they're teaching in school.
Oh, yeah, that Common Core math.
Yeah.
New math.
Oh, that's brilliant.
Yeah.
Okay, so... how did we work without the internet? Because in our young life, especially going into college, I mean, it was available, but it wasn't readily available.
That was kind of the spurring of the internet.
I suppose so.
03.
Well, so 03, we were in college, and I remember,
they had the computer lab.
Yes. We did not have internet access in our rooms.
Yeah, we did.
Did we?
Yeah, my roommate had his...
I never studied, so...
I didn't either.
So we
didn't... We just watched YouTube videos.
I don't even think YouTube was a thing yet.
Oh, no, it wasn't.
It was not.
That's where I was actually... I saw the very first episode, or not the episode, the video for Tenacious D's Blinker Gently.
Nice.
The little cartoon one.
Thank you for editing that out. I appreciate that.
You know, like I said, champion.
Do you remember Homestar Runner? in the late 90s that you had to look up
on their... Oh, yeah, that was E-Bomb's World.
Yes, and you had to look up on their individual website, and it was like a Flash player. And so it wasn't even a hosting site yet. It was just a Flash video.
Yep.
So I remember those, and they were super, super grainy.
That was like high school, so that would have been...
Yeah, late 90s.
Yeah.
Late 90s into 2000.
Yeah, late 90s.
And I remember the buffering.
Oh, God.
Remember the buffering circle?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that was always, that was exciting.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
And then we'd also touched upon this one about dial-up internet.
The old dial-up.
Oh, God.
So to answer the question, how did we work without the internet? And my answer immediately was better.
Yeah.
We actually worked.
We had to put in legwork for sure.
Yep.
We had to spend time in these ancient catacombs called libraries.
Yeah, with the old...
They had books and old Dewey.
Dewey Decimal System.
Dewey Decimal. And, yeah, that was a nightmare.
Yeah, it was.
I hated reading. Still do.
And I enjoy reading, and I enjoy the library. I still actually enjoy the library.
You got a library card?
I do have a library card.
I believe it.
And my library is about the size of this doghouse because I live in a tiny, tiny town. True story. True story.
That's hilarious.
I have donated books to my local library that they did not have.
I got like three bookshelves of books. And I thought about letting you have them so you could donate them. But I like to keep them.
So you look intelligent?
Because I look studious.
As you serve mead to your guests.
As I serve mead and charcuterie boards.
So look, everything changes. It changes all the time. So you go back to the early 1900s, and you got to change from horse-drawn carriages to the automobile.
Mm-hmm.
And then in the 50s, people might look back a few decades and say, how in the world did they do anything without cars? Well, they still did it. It was just different.
Slower.
Yeah, it was slower. That's a good way to put it.
Yeah.
So as we advance, we get faster at things. And ironically, we get dumber.
That's true.
We have an amazing set of technology literally at our fingertips, and we spend a lot of time looking up videos
stupid
about
crap
cats.
Listening to podcasts.
Imagine. Touche, sir. Touche. Imagine if Jefferson, or go back even farther to maybe Charles Spurgeon, or Martin Luther, go back to even some of the ancient Homer, and all these wonderful big thinkers would have had the availability of technology that we have today, the mindset that you can go online, you can find every bit of information in literally seconds, what they could have done with that.
E equals MC. Oh, look at the rack on that one.
do you think Mr. Einstein would have been a fan of the chive?
Oh, probably.
Probably, right?
I mean, who isn't?
It's a good question. Everybody's a fan of the chive.
That's a fair point.
So I don't really know. I think his answer, because he's anonymous and it's kind of a stupid question, it's definitely a Todd Tom.
Oh, yeah. Todd Tom. Speaking of Todd Toms.
Yes, but we'll get there. We'll get there.
Oh, okay.
We are going to get there.
We are.
I forgot all about Todd Tom.
Uh-huh.
Well, Todd Tom's weighing in today.
He is.
But to answer this question in its finality, you, sir, need to grow up just a little bit, because the 80s was only 30 years ago. That's just one generation.
Quite a bit has changed in that 30.
Yep. Now, ironically, this gentleman or lady could possibly be of drinking age and never experienced the internet in his... Or he could possibly be of drinking age and could have went his entire life only having the internet.
Whoa.
If he was born in January, he could be 21 years old right now. He could drink this mead with us right now.
Huh.
And never a point in his life.
Didn't have internet.
Did not have the internet.
Oh.
So we're definitely changing of the guards here.
Holy cannolis.
Just now, I'll blow your mind. You ready for this?
Do it.
You and I have never experienced an automobile without the capacity of an air conditioner.
Oh, I have.
Well, maybe I should
buy for available purchase.
Not by choice.
Power steering? I've been there too.
Now, both of us have done cars without power steering.
Yeah.
And both of us have had vehicles without air conditioning.
Uh-huh.
However, it's always been an option.
Sure.
And I was speaking with my father just the other day about his schooling when he was in elementary. They did not have air conditioners in their elementary school.
Oh, gross.
No swamp coolers, nothing.
Oh.
And I won't say how old he is because that's disrespectful and he might beat me. But
as he should.
It's just life advances.
Yeah.
And sometimes, you know.
Things go on, man.
Well, I don't know about this gentleman. I definitely hope that he learns to appreciate his elders.
That's
all
right.
I'm going to say.
Respect your elders.
Respect your elders. And I think now it's time, for our very, very first sponsor of the show. Here we go.
Do it. Have you ever been offended by somebody or something? Have you ever been super upset that your food came out wrong? Or even worse, not to your desired temperature? If this sounds like you, you need to call Todd Tom, disbarred attorney at law. When one-star reviews just don't seem to do the job, call 1-386-TODD-TOM. That's 1-386-863-3266. Again, that's 1-DUMB-TODD-TOM. Together, we can say, sue you.
Todd Tom is not a legitimate attorney, nor should he be consulted for anything. He is in this as a skit. If you're offended by this disclaimer, then feel free to call the number in the advertisement. Also, don't be a Todd Tom. This won't be a problem.
Beauty.
Right, that's beauty, eh?
Wonder how much Todd Tom paid us to have that advertisement in the show.
Oh, not enough.
Not enough. Well, I was going to charge him about $50.
About tree fitty?
But he's yet to fulfill those.
And he's not come through on legal advice yet.
So. Not at all. We've sent him several emails.
I mean, a disbarred attorney at law, you would think something be decent off of it.
We should have guessed whenever he left us 4 1-star reviews
and a very hateful voice message. Oh, goodness gracious.
Yeah,
that guy, I tell you what,
something else. Mr. Beezy, I believe you have our third and fourth question today, which actually has a little bit of an underlying theme to them.
Yes, puppies,
the canines.
Yeah. So these are going to be exciting. I really enjoy them.
Okay, question uno.
Well, I guess technically it's question three.
What do we say?
Uno.
Well,
but
it's your first.
My question
four.
Uno, but I digress. So this comes in from the ever-prevalent Anonymous.
Okay. Quite a few Anonymous questions.
I'm telling you. They're the best ones.
They are.
They're the greatest ones. It's a combination of the greatest and the best.
Nice. Thanks. The greatest ones. Hashtag the greatest ones.
Oh, snap. Another word?
Another one.
I did. All right. So Anonymous goes on to say, my pit bull attacked my 9-year-old son while he was celebrating whilst playing Fortnite. As one does when playing Fortnite. So, and then they say, my pit bull is very well trained. I've trained him consistently since he was a puppy.
Okay.
I told my son never dance, run, sing, yell, jump, talk too loud in front of the pit bull because that will provoke him to attack. We were chilling while my son was playing Fortnite after he won a close battle. He jumped up to celebrate and joy. Then Sin Valor, that's my pit bull's name, attacked my son for a few seconds. I was shocked and blamed my son for not listening to me. What's the best way to teach my son how to be around Sin Valor so he doesn't provoke him again?
The dog's name is Sin Valor.
Sin Valor. It's Sin hyphen Valor.
Oh, so it's not one word like Sinbad.
Oh, no, not Sinbad. It's Sin hyphen Valor. Which, by the way, I gotta say, that's a pretty dope name.
It really is.
I'm kind of digging it. I might have to do another D&D character and snag that name.
And I feel like it's fitting that we're drinking mead and talking about Sin Valor.
Sin Valor.
And we need to...
As we rise to Valhalla.
So what is the question? So he gives us...
Well, at the very end, the question comes in, what is the best way to teach my son how to be around Sin Valor so he doesn't provoke him again?
I feel like the man's... I feel like he's got it all backwards. just throwing that out there.
Oh, I would have to agree, man.
Now, I'm not... Look, disclaimer. We're not pity haters. I actually enjoy pit bulls.
Yeah, I can take it, believe
me. Okay, fair. I've had one that wandered onto our doorstep, and we actually adopted for a little bit. Yep. And she ended up dying. She was sick. But we cared for her, and I really enjoyed her. And I lived in New Mexico, and everybody has pit bulls in New Mexico.
Well, it's a prerequisite to live in New Mexico.
Apparently, it's a cultural thing. I don't know. I don't have a problem with pit bulls whatsoever. However, there's issues.
Yep.
When you have a dog that is genetically programmed to fight, that's what they're programmed to do. And then you raise them in your loving household, and then you blame your son for creating some sort of ruckus.
My favorite part is what he tells. These are the bylaws in this household. You cannot never dance, run, sing, yell, jump, or talk too loud. In front of the pit bull.
I will say, those are things that I typically don't do in my house. So I would probably be pretty safe with a pit bull.
Yeah, it's because you're not a very championistic video gamer.
That's true.
Like myself.
That's true. My my Minecraft games don't get out of control very often.
Well, I can see that.
So I think, obviously, Todd Tom question.
I would hope so.
I would hope so. I mean, there's obviously a bit of irony here, if you will. Maybe put the dog
down.
I was going to say put the dog outside.
I'm pretty sure that is a stipulation in Texas now, where if a dog bites you or a person, then it's a euthanization, I believe.
I don't think that qualifies as if it's your dog.
I don't think it matters.
I think if it's like somebody else's dog that attacks you or your children, then you can have them put down.
I don't think so.
You don't think any dog, for any reason?
You could legally, like, if my fat basset decided she wanted to go and bite me,
okay,
or my baby, because she was playing Fortnite.
She's old. She would kind of gum them.
Well, that's fair. But either way, I mean, I could say, look, she bit my baby, and I need you to do this now, and I'll pay you $150.
I don't know why this sounds so funny. She bit my baby. She bit my baby.
Ouch, Charlie, that hat.
All right, so your explanation is you got it backwards, and you need to put your dog down.
Yeah, for sure.
Or maybe... discipline your son.
I mean, that is the other perspective.
Maybe.
I mean, maybe the problem is the kid.
Maybe the kid just shouldn't have been acting a fool.
Maybe you should have had the kid.
Hey, that's a thought. So just have a pit bulls.
I mean, just get rid of the kids.
Instead of putting the dog down.
Put the kid down.
Or instigating the fight, you just put the kid down.
I mean, that's just the most logical explanation on this situation.
It makes perfect sense. So my advice to this gentleman is to just count his losses and put his kid up for adoption, or just, you know, get rid of him in the backyard.
Yeah, well, I will say that there was the favorite answer.
Okay.
Does say, your kid asked for it. It's not the pity's fault. I mean, he should have read the bylaws. It's in the Geneva Convention.
He shouldn't have been talking above a 4. And he was all the way up there at a 6.
You're at a 7. I need you about a 2. And you done crossed that threshold, son. So,
you get above a 5. Your life is void at that point.
You knew the dance, and you danced with the devil.
It's all up to the pit's discretion at that point. My question also is, what about the gentleman who's training the pit? Can he get
Oh, sure. Little... He has to be held liable for it.
Okay, no, I was going a different direction. I was thinking, can he get above a four?
Well, you know, he needs to be the one that's put down.
No, 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 I hear you. But I'm talking about with the pit. Like, how was his training for him?
Oh.
So could he dance and scream in the pit and be like, oh, that's my master?
No, it's in the bylaws.
Oh, okay. So this... this
the pit bull wrote the bylaws.
Oh, okay. So the pit bull...
He's alpha the dog in that house.
Okay, I got you. So nobody's allowed to do anything suspect.
Nobody.
Gotcha.
No sus in the house.
And also notice there's no wife involved here.
Yeah, probably not.
Maybe the pit bull ate her.
Oh.
Maybe she got out of line.
Maybe she was one of those holy Shiite evangelicals, and she was dancing with the ribbons down the hallways.
Well...
And Pitbull done had enough of that.
Yep, he couldn't handle that anymore.
Gobbled it up.
Maybe that's why he was pushed over the edge, and now we got to be so careful around the Pitbull.
That's why there's laws in the house. You want to end up like your mama?
So, what mama? Exactly.
Exactly. See that picture up there? She's not here no more because she danced.
That was her pre-pit experience.
Pre-pit.
Okay, so ridiculous question requires ridiculous answers.
Yes, loved it.
Get rid of the sun, keep the pit bull, and keep on white trashing it.
Yeah. I hope there's a PBR involved.
There should be.
Yeah, most definitely.
Definitely should be. Probably 30 of them.
Oh, at least.
Yep.
So good number of trace.
Yeah.
Let's hit question four.
All right, shoot.
Still involves... In the canine arenas.
Okay.
So, this comes from a kib.
What?
I don't know. A-K-I-B.
Okay.
So, a kib says, my son ate a lot of dog food. Goes on to say, my son, a kib junior. He lists the age. I will kind of hold off on the age because I want to have you guess on what you think the age is.
Okay, interesting.
Okay, so my son, a kib junior, ate my dog's food for lunch. He has problems, so this makes sense. He threw up four times in the past 2 hours. Should I be concerned?
Okay, so the kid, that there's no other explanation. He just has problems.
Uh-huh.
And he ate dog food.
Uh-huh. I've had four times in the last 2 hours. But all of this aside, I do want to get your guesstimation on age.
Okay, so if your kid ate dog food for lunch, I would assume they're not in school yet.
Okay.
Because they're with you for lunch. And this is probably a juvenile thing. I would say 4 or 5 tops.
Is that your final answer?
That's my final answer.
You are the weakest link. Goodbye. Well, the correct answer is a kib junior is 25 years old.
Wow. 25.
25.
Still at home, apparently.
Still. Well, he's got problems.
Apparently.
Doesn't make sense.
Do you think this is the same kid who asked what it was like working before the internet?
Before the internet. I mean, he could have just Googled, is dog food good for you?
Oh, there you go. And is kib maybe a little kickback to a kibble?
A kibble?
Because if you're eating kibble.
A kibble and bit?
There you go.
Maybe that's a kibble's bit.
Hey, it is a kibble's bit. Kibble's bit just happens to be throwing up 4 times after you eat kibble. Okay, does it specify if it's wet or dog food? Or dry dog food?
Dry or wet? No, it does not say, okay, unfortunately. Right.
In my mind, I'm going with dry.
Of course. Yeah, or mean, you'd have to.
If he's got real problems, maybe he put it in a bowl with milk because he thought it was
got that
cereal.
Gravy going on.
And instead of Captain Crunch, he got kibble gravy.
I will say.
Kibbles and gravy.
All shenanigans aside, I remember growing up back in the day.
Please don't tell
me. My pops had Rotties and the Rottweilers.
Okay, thank you.
So,
did you notice the blank stare I was giving you?
I did. Yeah, you kind of look like a deer in a headlight. So
A Rottie?
A Rottie. So, anyways, so he had this dog food that he would get, I think, from like Tractor Supply or something, and it was called Mealtime or something. Okay. But Or no, it was Gravy Train.
Gravy Train.
Bro, and you mix that with water, and holy crap, it smelled delicious.
What?
It smelled so freaking good, man. I wanted to have a nibble. I never did, because, I mean, I didn't have those problems.
Is this question actually about you? Like, are you the one who ate the dog food?
I'm a kib. Sorry. Hey, caught me.
So 25 years old, eats the dog food, throws up 4 times. And the question is, should I be concerned?
Should I be concerned?
Without a doubt, 100%. Absolutely should be concerned with your parenting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that feels right.
Yeah.
That feels like that should be the correct answer.
I think so. If you know that there's an issue with stuff like that, maybe put your dog food out of reach of this gentleman or lady.
Or you should probably replace the dog food with the medication that he's probably not off. Taking.
Yes. Oh, or goodness. I guess you could, if he's really prone to dog food, maybe he takes pills like a dog and you need to put pills in.
In the dog food so he can eat the pills?
I was going to say in hot dogs and give it to him.
or just jam it in some peanut butter and throw it in the roof of his mouth and watch him.
I mean, obviously, there's some issues going on.
I mean, that could be fun.
What?
Put it on YouTube.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Get more hits than what we got.
Yeah, that's fair.
So I'm trying to think, what kind of problems would an individual have to warrant the eating of dog food and it be at least in some form or fashion okay?
Well, with my studies in the psychoanalysis.
How many years have you been doing that?
About 13.
Okay, great.
So it's a mild case of schizophrenia.
He thinks he's a dog.
Or animate object feelings. So he feels he needs to eat the dog food.
Well, why, though?
I don't know. Oh, okay. I haven't studied him. He doesn't come into my therapy sessions.
You have to be around him personally, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, you got to get a firsthand experience.
Okay. Let's suppose, which is it's a stretch to say this is a legit question.
Fair.
You should definitely be concerned, number one. Uh-huh. And you should take steps to rectify this particular situation.
Yeah. I will say, though, in the health field that I've been in. So, dog food technically is not bad.
Correct.
For human consumption.
It is edible.
Yes. It's made of offal.
Yes. So it's edible at the very basic level of the term.
Yes. That is true.
But,
I mean, if you're consuming a Jethro bowl of dog food with milk, I mean,
yeah.
I mean, that may be a little unsettling to the stomach. However,
I believe so.
It is technically not bad for you unless it was a legitimate child and he wasn't 25. It does pose a choking hazard. So
I guess. Did you just say illegitimate child? What does that have to do with it? The child was born out of wedlock.
No, I said so legitimate.
Legitimate child. Okay.
Legitimate child and not 25.
Okay, let's give them the benefit of the doubt briefly. Because that's what it warrants. Very brief benefit of that. Let's say you have a child that has issues and he's homebound and, you know, that happens from time to time.
Yeah.
And said child eats some dog food and throws up. Should you be concerned? I would say mildly concerned because, like you said, I mean, technically it's edible. Technically it's not going to poison you or anything like that. It's not going to do any long-term damage. Mm-hmm. I would be concerned with how and why this came about. So again, even on the very most gracious giving a benefit to this person, mm-hmm. your parenting needs to improve.
Uh-huh.
I can't stress that enough.
Some medications, definitely.
Probably for you as the parent.
So
you can take care of your child better.
Let me throw you this.
Okay.
What if a kib is actually fabricating all of this and he's off his meds?
Ooh.
He has a psychotic break and pretends that he has a kid that's 25 and eating dog food when it's really him.
That is actually him?
bum, bum, bum.
Did we just...
We inceptioned it.
How many characters have you played in this particular film? Oh, man.
And it's a movie, and it's played by John Malkovich.
Nice.
But I will say, yeah, I mean, definitely medications, medications, medications.
Yep, all the way around, it sounds like.
Yes, for sure. But I will say, one of the greatest and the top answer made me chuckle. I enjoyed it.
Okay.
It says, unless you catch him in the driveway licking his unmentionables, you haven't a thing to worry about.
Oh. Okay. I can go with him on that.
I like it.
That's fair. Right, now, well, if you do catch them in the driveway going to town on their unmentionables, then you got some real world issues there.
Called dog catcher.
Dog the bounty hunter. I'm pretty sure he could use the money.
Yep. That's funny.
Oh, great four questions. Let's go right into Thinky Blinders. How about that?
Thinky Blinders. Thinky Blinders.
Thinky Blinders. All right, so just to sum up, in case you guys don't know, four questions we kind of banter about before. We know the questions. We know what's we know what's in them. We've talked about it beforehand. Thinky Blinders is a little bit different. It is, well, as the title suggests, blind to us. I come up with a question for Beezy, and Beezy comes up with a question for me, and we have to kind of answer on the fly.
Off the cuff.
Off the cuff, even better. I'm going to go first this time.
I like it.
My question to you is probably one that immediately you're going to have an answer for. Okay. Then I want you to dial it back. Uh-huh. Think about it.
Thank you.
Thank you, blinder it. And also consider out there, all of you listeners, he is without a shirt on most of the time.
Okay.
Like, it's not just a podcast thing.
I'm already liking this.
Okay, so here's the question. Mr. Beezy, in what context in life are you afraid or worried to speak out your own mind/opinion? When in your life do you dial it back?
Oh, so I know where you're going with that. My initial response is never.
Exactly. Most of the time that I've been around you, no regard for other people's opinion about you.
So as I dial it back a smidge, we're pumping the brakes a bit.
Got a thinky blinder it.
I don't have a thinky blinder it. So I will have to say the podcast is something that
interesting.
Most certainly, I wouldn't say censor myself.
Okay.
But I, much like my palate, I refine it.
You did polish off Natty Light last week in true form. So I don't know how refined it is.
Champion refinement.
All right.
But yeah.
Can you give any other examples where you might have dialed it back via the podcast?
Oh yeah, because I have a couple of go-to words as fillers.
Okay.
And just regular, good, wholesome family fun go-tos.
And we're going to shy away from those still.
Yeah, we still will.
We're going to leave that out there for your mind to think about a little bit.
Yeah, throw us what you think they might be on the Facebooks.
We would not appreciate that, but still do it.
I just email it to us.
There you
That'd
go.
Probably be better.
Or better yet, go over to Rocky Johnson's YouTube site and put it on his comment section.
We'll use Rocky Johnson's YouTube page as a sounding board.
Oh, man, how great would that be? By the way, it's Rocky Jackson. I can't even remember his name correctly.
We're terrible.
But definitely go to Rocky Jackson's YouTube page and leave him ridiculous comments. And tell him that we sent you.
But yeah, I mean, back to the question, for sure, the podcast for sure is something that I dial it back quite a bit.
I know for a fact that there's been some inside innuendo jokes that we've glossed over.
Well, it may have been a gloss over for you, but it was it was internal strife for me, brother.
Really having to...
There's some bubbling going on, and it's not from the tamales.
Yeah, that that holding in on your part sometimes is a little difficult.
It's extremely difficult. So I want to thank you for that.
You're very welcome. Very welcome. And the three church people that listen to this, they thank you as well.
They deserve it. I do it for you guys.
Oh, man. That's good. Any other time in, like, quote-unquote mixed society, do you feel like you dial it back just a smidge?
You know, it depends. I typically try to keep my candor. Is that?
Yeah, that's...
Does that feel good?
Yeah, I like that.
I try to keep my candor, especially when I'm around... older people.
Okay.
People much older than me. When I was doing stuff with the Masons.
Yes.
I definitely wasn't throwing down F-bombs and C-bombs and all that kind of...
That's right.
Good stuff that I tend to hover around.
Yes. And the Freemasons might come and get us after this, so I won't give up too much, but we're both Masons at the table. And in some of our rituals didn't require a shirt. So you might have fit right in.
You know, that is a valid point.
All right. So moving on from the Masons, because we might get assassinated, which is possible.
That is true.
All right. Didn't mean to offend Freemasons out there. We love you. We're doing the secret handshake right now as we speak. And also plotting to take over the world.
Yep.
Illuminati. Well, I know for a fact that when I'm around anybody, I usually dial things back. I don't take things seriously like a lot of people do. And when I say I don't take things seriously, I really mean that. There are very, very few things that I take seriously in life. And a lot of people don't have that opinion.
Yeah.
And so I really try to dial things back a great deal around most folks just because of my profession and as well as not wanting to offend and blah 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 and on and on and on.
That comes with the job title.
It does. But I was curious because I know you're a little less how shall we say constrained by those.
Colorful.
Yeah. Definitely more colorful, that is for sure.
I will say the one thing that's nice about this is I attempt to expound on my vocabulary.
Okay, there you go.
Boom.
Expound's a good word.
I know. I learned it today.
There are some etymologists out there that would laugh.
Word nerds.
Oh, the word nerds unite.
Oh, that's a shout out to your other podcast.
It is.
The Skeptical Zealot.
Skeptical Zealot. You should check that out. And we deal with the Christian approach to a lot of topics in a non-serious way. Like we take a lot of topics and we discuss them, all the ins and outs, and we don't get too serious about all the ins and outs. Mm-hmm. We present the issues, we present the sides, and then we discuss them. And that's it.
Yeah,
that's it. It's good stuff.
I'm enjoying it.
And as a matter of fact, this latest one is all about alcohol and whether or not Christians can drink alcohol. So as we drink this mead, you can guess my my opinion on that.
I think I know your stance.
Yes, but check that podcast out if you have the time. So I like your answer. Anything else you want to kind of book in that?
No, I mean, I try to accommodate. If it's new people, I'll test the waters.
Fair.
And then just kind of see where it goes. Just to be safe, because you never know who that other person is that you're talking to that might want to invest in, say, our podcast.
Hey, there you go. There you go. We aim to please.
Aim to please.
Now, bonus, have you ever been in a situation where you have chosen maybe not to censor, or you've been to a certain inebriated point in your life where it wasn't an option to censor, and you may spoke too much and suffered some repercussions?
Oh, I'm certain I've done that.
But you don't remember?
I don't remember. Why I was too inebriated, bro.
One of the first memories I have of you and I kind of being together in a way where I saw this side of you was our first trip to Colorado.
Okay.
And there's this family that always goes up there with my family. We had kind of become friends.
People from Kansas?
Yeah, the Kansas folks. Uh-huh. And we called them the Bloody Kansas folks, something like that. I don't know. It was anyway. So I introduced you to these people, and your immediate response to them was, I believe, a sentence with three F words in it.
That sounds about right.
I'm pretty sure that's right. And yeah. I don't even think you had been drinking up to that point.
Nah, I was still sober.
I think it was just because it was in Colorado.
Yeah.
And, you know, well, wild and free up there.
We connected. There's one of the guys who was a Texas Tech guy.
Yes, one guy. And the other 80 people at the table were like, oh, good Lord.
Well, they did have a bunch of family from a surrounding suburb.
That's true.
So we connected. I connected with a couple of them. So it just, you hit that connection and then, you know, the bombs fly.
And they did. And I was mortified.
I know.
It was great.
Good times.
Good times. Thinky Blinder number two.
All right. So, and I'm very interested to hear your response on this, because this isn't a typical Beezy Thinky Blinder.
Okay. So I take it it's on a serious note.
Yeah, I guess you could say so.
Okay.
So what books should teens read as they become an adult?
Great question. Okay, so when you say teens,
I would say high school graduation age, okay. Going from 17, 18,
okay.
And then about to the break 20s. Into the proverbial adulthood.
Okay, all right. Okay, I'm going to start with one that I promise is not a church answer or a pandering answer. You need to be reading your Bible. And I don't mean that as the pastor telling you need to read your Bible because of necessarily spiritual reasons. There are wonderful things to be able to pull out of Scripture that you need to be well-versed in. So I would say read your Bible and do it every day. Do a little bit every day. That would be my recommendation.
Yep.
Okay. There's two fiction novels right out of the gate that I think need to be included. The first one is A Heartbreaking Work of Staggering Genius by Eggers. It is a beautiful novel. I think it definitely deserves a shout out, and I would put that on your reading list. The other one is House of Leaves, which is a horror novel, not W-H-O-R-E novel, but horror novel.
A horror novel?
Yes, and very good, very in-depth. If you like Stephen King novels, this one will blow the socks off most of those. Fantastic book. Going into nonfiction, I would definitely give John Eldridge a look, Wild at Heart. All of those Christian spiritual books that he has written from a psychological standpoint, very much pragmatic, down-to-earth. I would read C.S. Lewis, The Screwtape Letters, and a lot of his other books are fantastic. I would read all books by Charles Spurgeon. Any book that you can get from him, I would definitely read. Even his books on sermons, I would read those.
I didn't want your entire library catalog.
Hang on, we're gonna keep going. You got the wheels turning.
Poor Charles, hamster.
Charles Sturgeon, 12 Rules for Life by Jordan Peterson.
Okay,
definitely read that one. That was a tough read. So was Spurgeon. But those two are difficult.
That name is a tough read.
Definitely read 12 Rules for Life. And read or attempt to read the Federalist Papers. And here is one reason.
Okay.
The Federalist Papers were written in the late 1700s to farmers.
Okay.
And if you try to read it, now I say farmers, it was written to the American people. But most of the American people were agrarian, farmer, uneducated folk, quote unquote.
Fair.
And if you try to read it today, you're going to need help.
A thesaurus.
You will. Or what's the little yellow book thing that comes with Spark Notes? You're going to need Spark Notes because it's very, very difficult. And it will show you how far we have come from just a few hundred years ago in our literary prowess. These are very difficult to read. All right, let me go through the classics. You need to read some of the classics. You need to read the Odyssey and the Iliad. You need to read Virgil's Aeneid. You need to read Don Quixote. You need to read Moby Dick. You need to read Hemingway, especially The Old Man and the Sea, if you're a guy. Yeah. And you need to...
Dick.
See, there you go. There's one of those things that you probably should have censored yourself.
That'd be all right.
You need to read Atlas Shrugged. You need to read The Color Purple. And I know you're not going to like me for saying this. You need to read The Hobbit and Lord of the Rings in their original full-form novels. You also need to read To Kill a Mockingbird. You need to read 1984. And you need to read Crime and Punishment. On top of that, I would add, you need to read some business ethic books. Dale Carnegie, John Maxwell, and all of their ilk. I would definitely include that. And there is one book that, especially if you're a young man, you need to read. And that book is by a man named Stephen Ranella, and it's called The American Buffalo.
Yeah.
I'm on a buffalo.
I'm on a buffalo.
Now, I'll admit, we kind of sort of had that in the bag, because you knew I were going to say that book.
Yeah.
Great YouTube series. You could tell them that we sent you as well, but they have a whole bunch of comments, so it won't be quite as effective.
Yeah, that's true.
But that book by Stephen Ranella, American Buffalo, it brings in life lessons. It brings in how to deal with your dad and how to deal with your dad's passing at some point, how to deal with working your way in and around girls in your young life, and he talks about hunting, and it's such a wonderful modern day book for a young man. I think it's a great read, and everybody should check it out.
Interesting.
So that would be my list, and there are countless others I could mention. I'm a reader, man.
Yeah.
And so see, some of clearly. These books are just. I would definitely take a look at the classics that I mentioned. There's just so much in those classics, especially like the Odyssey and the Aeneid by Virgil, that our ethics classes have just gone out the window. We don't do it anymore. And man, we should. We miss a whole bunch. But start with that list and then just start kind of branching out from there.
I was always a fan of, what was that book? Lord of the Flies.
Lord of the Flies is a great book.
I enjoyed it.
Yep. Yep, Lord
Mainly
of Flies.
Because they made a movie of it.
What? And you could watch the movie?
I didn't have to read the whole book. I got all the cliff notes.
I take it. Cliff notes. That's what I was trying to think of, that little yellow book.
Cliff notes,
not Spark
I was
notes.
Thinking How to Read for Dummies, like the Dummy series.
So I take it you had a book project one time, and instead of reading it, you're like, I'll just watch the movie.
I mean, I trust Tom Hanks to get it all in there for me.
The books that I have chosen to do that, I always got a solid C-.
Well.
If I was lucky.
You weren't good enough.
I guess not. I actually had to read the book.
Ah,
any other books that you can think of that you would add to that particular list?
Oh, man. I would say... Penthouse forums, and just to round the whole list off, Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover.
That's your contribution.
Yep.
Penthouse forum and Dave Ramsey's Total Money Makeover.
Total Money Makeover.
If you're going to be perverted, you might as well be rich too, right?
I mean, you got to make that money, baby.
Got some of that penthouse scratch.
Got this penthouse scratch.
Oh man,
you did some Ramsey stuff, yeah? Like
I did. So Ramsey used to have something in Nashville where you could go and kind of study with his team for a week, and he would give you this little kind of a certificate for financial counseling.
Okay.
And so I was involved with the church. I wasn't in ministry at the time, and they shipped me out there and they paid for everything. And I came back and I started ministering to couples and individuals that had financial issues. And that's actually how I got my start into ministry. I didn't go to seminary school. I didn't do the traditional route to get into the pastorate, but I kind of worked my way up. I started counseling individual couples, and then I moved into youth and music, and then just youth, and then eventually kind of fell in love with the pulpit, and they were like, hey, you're decent at talking in front of folks, so why don't you just get up there and do that full time? And, you know, that's why they pay me the big bucks
now. So you've been knowing the Ramsey about 11 to 12 years.
Man, I've been listening to Ramsey since 05, 05, 06 on the radio, yeah. So a long time. And I'm pretty sure Ramsey still owes me some money. Pretty sure. So Dave Ramsey, if you're out there, you should write me some of that Ramsey scratch.
Cough up some of that penthouse scratch.
little bit of insight about how I was in this age. So I was mid-20s, 25, 26, very timid, not outspoken yet, as I am now, probably more than most people appreciate.
Ever.
Yep. We went and I literally studied with Ramsey and his team for 5 full days. And at the end of it, he had everybody line up, and he was taking pictures with folks. and I didn't want to take his picture. I didn't want to take a picture with him.
So you know the old adage, pics or it didn't happen. So
I do have pictures, just not with him. Apparently it didn't happen. I shook his hand and I told him thank you, but I didn't want to take a picture with him. And in hindsight, this was before I was on social media of any kind. I should have.
Yep.
Because, man, I could have got like 10 likes out of that.
Like $2-3 out of it, maybe. That'd be great.
You know. Good times. And you know what we could do? Because he's never going to sponsor. We could hold him ransom. We could say, hey, we'll release this unless.
I am pretty sure that he does not have Todd Tom's attorney at law his financial court.
I don't think so. I imagine he's got some pretty legit lawyers on retainer.
A team.
Yeah, probably.
I would venture to say a team.
Yeah, yeah. He's doing quite well for himself.
Not hurting. Faux show.
But even in our crazy days, both of us have been fans of Ramsey.
Yeah. Yeah, we actually did some of the snowball effect thing that he's got.
It works.
Yeah, it really does.
It works. It sucks.
Yeah.
And it's time-consuming.
Most certainly
is.
It's not
glamorous, but it works.
A lot of bologna sandwiches.
Yeah, yeah, for sure, for sure. Well, I appreciate Thinky Blinders.
Yeah.
Good one this week.
It was decent.
Now, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, we have a brand new segment that we're going to introduce this week.
Brand new.
Okay, I'm going to let Beezy take over all of those introduction forums.
So this segment we're going to call Reverend Reflections.
I like it.
Yeah. Well, so being that we have a on-staff reverend.
Bona fide. Bona fide. No degree.
No degrees.
No qualifications.
So we actually got a really awesome email. It is now, granted, I'm not sure how legit the sender is because it's from Annie Namas.
Okay. All right.
But
so we're going to go with Annie.
We're going to go with Annie.
Okay.
So Annie says, I found your podcast browsing Spotify, and I have a question to the pastor. Probably wise.
Okay.
At my church, there is a kid that is always distracting everyone. The kid is 10 and has autism. His mom won't put him in our children's church, and he is not quiet during the service. If his mom can't control him, I feel she should leave him at home. What do you do about kids in your church? Do you make them go to the children's room if they are making others miss your message? I don't think our pastor has said anything to his mom. Thanks, Annie.
Hmm. First and foremost, tough question.
Yeah.
And a tough circumstance. It's hard for everyone. It's hard for the congregants. It's hard for the pastor. And it's hard for that family. So let me start by saying, as of 6 years ago, I would have answered it in one way and one way only. You need to talk to the mom. She needs to take control of the situation. And if she can't control the situation, she needs to remove her and her child from the service. And the way that you do that is, or the reason that you do that is because you're disrupting the flow of things. You're disrupting service. And like Annie said, the message is a lot of times it's disturbed from other people's perspectives.
Sure.
However, I'll give another part of that answer. 5 years ago when we started our church, I guess it's been 6 years now that we started our church in Albuquerque, there was a young couple and they had a girl, and this daughter that they had autism.
Okay.
And now they knew something was wrong around a year and a half. So they worked through the process from figuring out there was something going on to diagnosing the issue and then dealing with the issue. And okay. So I walked with them through this whole process. Something that we maybe fail to remember or think about is the empathy that we should be showing to that particular family. That sure. mom and that dad can literally go nowhere and feel normal. Normal doesn't exist for them. Mm. And of all the places they should be able to come to and feel loved and cared for and be quote-unquote normal, should be their church.
Sure.
They should be able to come to their family and feel accepted and loved and cared for. If they can't, there's no reason for them to be in that church.
Yeah.
So I have two minds. The first one is my crazy brain and the way that it works with perfection in a service. Uh-huh. It needs to go well. It needs to flow. There needs to be very, very, needs to be no gaps of silence. And also there needs to be no interruptions.
Sure.
So if you have a screaming toddler in the back that's constantly disrupting things, it's an issue and you need to address that issue. Mm-hmm. However, the trump card to that is that family literally has no other place to go. There's a great possibility that you cannot place that autistic child in a children's
class
because they can't, the teacher can't handle it. They're not equipped. They don't want to. And
could
maybe
get violent with the other children.
It could get violent. Maybe it's not fair to the other children. There's a host of reasons that a mom wouldn't place her child.
Fair.
So you've got to have empathy for the family. And if you're not willing to make some sort of adjustments for the family, number one, I don't think they should be in your church. They deserve to be there just like everybody else. Mm-hmm. You've got issues too. Just because your issue isn't disrupting service doesn't mean that you don't have issues. You got to love on people. So you need to accept them. And I will say, if you're a church leader out there, there is a great swath of people that don't feel accepted in church because of this issue, because they have problematic, quote unquote, problematic children. Now, they might not be eating dog food like the earlier child, but they've got problems that they don't feel, quote unquote, normal. And when you don't feel normal and you don't feel accepted, you're not going to go.
Yeah.
And it's not only unfair to your church to love on that family, but also it's extremely unfair to that family. It's a very fine line. And it's one you really have to look at from all different angles, not just from the angle of for 1 hour a week, I'm aggravated that this child won't shut up.
Sure.
And a lot of times I think that's where it comes down to. We're uncomfortable, so we want to make sure that we deal with that issue.
Yep.
But we haven't considered the fact that they're uncomfortable literally all the time.
Yeah.
And you can't go to Walmart because if you take your child into Walmart, they're going to have a meltdown.
Yeah.
And you can't be around family because your child's going to have a meltdown. And you can't go to the park because your child's going to have a meltdown.
Mm-hmm.
So where do you go to feel accepted? Hopefully you can go to your church. And that would definitely be my answer / non-answer because it's really not an answer. The best thing I could say is to love on that family and to try to get to know them and to get to know that child.
Yeah.
And have some empathy because it does matter.
Yeah. Well, I know I've been pastoral and I remember back in my first church in 58. 1958.
Man.
We wouldn't settle for it.
I'm sure 1950s Christians would have loved you.
Yeah.
Especially Baptists.
Fire and brimstone. Fire and brimstone.
Yeah.
We wouldn't settle for it. but my new church that I'm pastoral in.
Pasteurizing.
No, that's what you do with milk.
Oh, that's right.
Homogenizing and pasteurizing. we would look at accommodating them best we could. Definitely, we'd find somebody that could work with the child and then have their own separate class. Have an individual class.
In the 50s.
Church. No, I'm talking about the new one now.
Oh, I got you.
The new one now.
Okay.
We would accommodate if mother needed a cry room or something along those lines. So if the child was able to make a connection with a congregant.
Yes.
Then that person just got signed up and voluntold. They're teaching a class.
Yeah.
With that child.
For that one child.
For that one child.
It's actually a really good workaround.
Well, that's why you asked my input.
So,
because I'm a problem solver.
You are a problem solver. Annie out there, I understand fully your predicament. And just know that stuff like that infuriates and aggravates me to no end week after week after week because it always seems to happen. But the other side is important also to realize and understand. So
I will say, Annie Namas, thank you very much. That was a,
it's a great beautiful
yep. inauguration for Reverend Reflections.
Inauguration?
I don't know. I'm telling you, bro.
A wonderful. We're nerds unite.
Unite.
If you have some questions for the pastor, you should definitely send us an email at
theseguysquestions@gmail.com.
Gmail.com. Yeah.
I had a stroke there for a second.
Yeah. I struggle with it as well.
Yeah, that will happen.
I bring that email up every day, and I still struggle with it. I don't know why.
I've literally got it up on the laptop right now.
Send us your questions, and we will do our best to answer them in a timely fashion. Understand that we get literally no questions every week, so we'll probably be able to fit you in real quick.
We get literally ones and ones of questions every month or so.
We read all of your comments.
Yes.
all three of them. Don't forget to go to Randy Jackson's page and leave a comment on his YouTube site.
Is it Randy Jackson? It's not Randy Jackson.
It's not Randy Jackson.
No, it can't be Randy Jackson because...
You have a samurai sword?
I mean, is that a pretty recognizable smudge?
Maybe that's the joke from now on. We go to his site and comment and just call him the wrong name.
Randy Jackson from American Idol.
It's Rocky Jackson.
Rocky Jackson. Dude, you should remember that. Rocky.
Rocky.
It's the name of your friggin' dog.
Yeah, that's true. I just, for whatever reason, I can't. And his flagship title album is Testify.
Testify.
And that's where we find the wonderful song In the Doghouse Now.
Love it.
Well, we want to thank you so much for joining us today and for subscribing and liking and commenting, all that stuff. We appreciate every single interaction that we have. Reach out to us. Go visit our sponsors. Go try out some wonderful mead if you get a chance.
Yes.
Go check out our Facebook page, our Instagram page. Send us an email. We have a website that's coming soon. You can actually check it out right now, but it's in very much a beta stage.
Yes.
And it is fwtgpodcast.com. I don't know why we had to do that in almost unison.
And as we shook our head every single time.
It was because both of us were a little bit unsure.
Yeah.
But we...
we were sinking with the ship.
We solidified. So you can check out that website. We'll have much more coming. And also, hopefully in the next couple of weeks when we launch the full website, we'll have the availability for you to leave us voicemails.
Yes.
And we can listen to those voicemails on the episodes.
On air.
Yeah.
As they say in the biz.
We're not in the biz.
That's fair.
How many subscribers do we have to be in the biz?
Quite a few more than we've got.
Okay. Well, I think the last count about we had was more. Four. So
18.
We have as many subscribers as Rocky Jackson does.
We got more than him just on YouTube alone.
On YouTube. Thanks, Mom and Dad. We appreciate it.
I will say, I know we touched on last week's episode about the Patreon. We are dealing with a couple of issues on that end.
Yep.
So it is not currently 100% active. We will work our hardest to try and get that rolling in the next couple of weeks.
By the end of January.
By the end of January, we should hopefully have that rocking and rolling, so you should be able to find us there. Feel free to keep poking your heads around there.
Yep.
Searching for Fraternize with These Guys on Patreon.
Yep. And all you Patreon subscribers, we will do something for you. Maybe extra episodes or some question and answer formats.
Yeah. Like when we had the bonus episode.
Yeah.
You might just have straight bonus episodes.
That would be exciting.
Could be fun.
You can also, I mean, look, you subscribe to our Patreon account. We'll teach you how to build a shop.
I mean, build a shop.
I can teach you. We can teach you how to fly fish.
Shoot a riffle.
We can totally do that.
We can show you how to shoot somebody with a pistol when they try to sledgehammer your AR.
Oh, that's right. Now, what we won't do is give you any ammunition because that's like solid gold right now.
Oh, dude. That's ridiculously expensive right now.
BYOA.
Yeah, bring your own ammos.
Just a couple of things real quick. We'll have the next episode, number 8.
Numero 8.
Man, really kept getting up there. So we'll have in the next episode just kind of a normal episode. And then after that, we're going to be on the road.
Yeah.
Our road again. we're actually going to be going east.
Yeah.
Into the
East Tejas.
The deep east woods of Texas.
No, I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, me too. So we're going to be going and doing some bass fishing at the probably the greatest bass lake in the country, Lake Fork.
Yep.
We're really excited about that.
Pretty stoked, man. Yep.
So we'll be on the road for that week. We're going to do 2 episodes on the road. So that'll be the last... That'll be the first Thursday in February.
There you go.
And the second Thursday of February. Those will be those 2 episodes. We're excited about it. Well, thank you guys so much again. We appreciate you guys. God bless you. And we're going to leave off with our ponder this.
Ponder this? You know what's creepy about Humpty Dumpty? They never said that it was an egg.
Ooh. All right, you guys. See you next week.
Next week. Love you guys.